Mesdames et messieurs, bon matin, bon après-midi et bonsoir et bienvenue au podcast No Respect. Yes, that's right, ladies and gentlemen. That's maybe a little taste of what's to come for today's episode, a little French segment. And for those of you who are new, welcome aboard. My name is Mackie, and join alongside me tonight, as per usual, are Alex and Justin. Let's start with you, Justin. How are you?
Ça va bien, mon gars.
I'm ready to
talk some not very active Habs schedule this week, obviously, because of the COVID outbreak in the Habs dressing room. But excited to speak some French and speak about some Habs.
Yeah, it's going to be brutal. So please bear with us, all of our Francophone listeners that are much better than us at French. But Alex, how are you?
Yeah, I'm good. Like you both said, I am pretty nervous about this French thing, but excited to get this episode going. No games to talk about, but we do have some pretty exciting news, so let's get into it.
That is correct. Way to segue right into it. Ladies and gentlemen, this week, where we weren't sure if we're actually going to record because there was not much to talk about, of course, it turns out that there's quite a bit to talk about, some big news items, starting off with Mr. Eric Staal becoming a Montreal Canadian for a third and a fifth round pick. So, of course, Eric Staal is now, I don't know, is he 37 years old? 36, around that age?
36.
What is he? Yeah. 36. So, obviously not the player that he once was. Marc Bergevin said it pretty often. He says, c'est pas un joueur de 25 ans. So he's not a player that's 25 years old. He is obviously in the second half of his career here. But an interesting move from a GM that was supposed to be inactive. So let's just go around the table here and see how you guys feel about this trade. Alex, let's start with you.
Yeah, I think like most fans, I'm pretty pleased with it. I don't think there's much to be concerned about when it comes to what we gave up to get Eric Staal. And I think worst case, he's a fourth line center on this team. So I don't think there's much of a downside. Realistically, he's an upgrade over Jake Evans. Jake Evans has been playing okay and had a really good start to the year, but you can't say that Eric Staal would be a worse piece than Jake Evans at this current time. I think he could have a bigger impact than people believe. I've seen a lot of people on Twitter and stuff who are hopeful that he could have a bigger impact, and I think leaving Buffalo could motivate any player in the league. His comments so far have seemed positive. He's happy to be coming to Montreal. He had to waive part of his no move or no trade clause to come to Montreal. He knows a few of the guys in the room. Obviously a big veteran player who's had success. He's won a cup. So, I don't think there's anything not to like with this move.
What about you, Justin? Anything not to like?
Yeah, I think, there's little to no risk in this move. I mean, we already have, I think, 12 picks after the trade in the upcoming draft. So there's not much, like I said, much risk. This player can be just an upgrade on the fourth line, like Alex said. And I think still has something left in the tank. He had 47 points in 66 games last season. Obviously, this season it was a bit tougher in Buffalo with 10 points in 32 games. But, I mean, he's shown that he can still put up points. Like, he was 35 years old and he was inching close to a point per game. Well, I mean, that's maybe wishful thinking but
a little bit.
Yeah. Like a point per game percentage. You know, like good. For it's 35 good. Years old, that's pretty good. So I'm expecting, I'm hopeful to have the kind of a similar result as Corey Perry was. Like, we had kind of have an older player coming in that we knew in the past was very proven and had skill and could put the puck in the net. And now they're older, but they still have something left in the tank. So I'm expecting that to make an impact. And from his comments, like, he had the interview on Zoom when he came to Montreal, I think it was this morning on Sunday. And he seemed very, very eager to play. He wanted the big minutes. He didn't want to just be a support cast. Like, he was willing to play that role, but he was hungry for more. He still wants to play hockey a lot. He still wants to be that guy that plays as much minutes as he's able to. And yeah, I think it's all positive things when it comes to him. I just hope he can put it together for the Montreal Canadiens. And if he can't, then we have other pieces that can obviously fill the role that that he has. So I'm obviously not worried about this deal.
Yeah, the direct quote that you're talking about is the fact that he was saying that, you know, I'm always going to want to play 25 minutes a night, something along those lines. And that if you don't have that mentality, then I just don't, you know, he didn't really know why you wouldn't have that mentality. So it goes to show you, he's a competitor. Everything that you guys said, I do completely agree in that the fact that we had 14 picks heading into this year's draft, we're giving up a third and a fifth. And from what I gather is that we still have a third and a fifth. So we're really not losing anything. You, in terms of proper asset management, when you have an abundance of something to get something that can help, this is a little bit about, you know, what Marc Bergevin does. And they retain salary, which is another thing, because or else it wouldn't have happened. So that's an important note. I think I can't remember how much they retained specifically, but it's enough for the team to be under the cap, obviously. And like you guys said, the main thing for me, for Eric Staal, is he brings, once again, a presence. Now, maybe some of the people that are looking on the other side of the coin, the negative side of the coin, is like, this is the type of deal that you would have wanted done 5 years ago when he was in his prime. And what I would tell you then is that it wouldn't have cost a third and a fifth round pick, and you didn't have a prospect pool, all of these things. So let's start off with that. And I just think, again, a centerman such as Eric Staal being able to be alongside in a flight, in the bathroom, in the shower, wherever it may be, he's going to give you some tips, maybe too many tips, if you know what I mean. But to the young guys, in the sense that they're there to learn from a guy that's won. He's another member of the whatever six-time All-Star, triple gold club, you name it, Stanley Cup winner. This is just a great presence for this locker room. As simple as that. So I don't see how anybody could be angry with this. Maybe you wanted something more like a Jack Eichel, and it's not the type of move that you can do, especially this year in COVID. So I don't know.
And another thing that we might talk about it later, but in Marc Bergevin's press conference, he kind of talked about, I think it was, I forget who asked the question, but someone was asking, why do you think these veteran players that come into Montreal, like Ilya Kovalchuk, like Corey Perry, we've seen others in the past, and now Eric Staal, why do you think they've been successful? And he talked about how it's a Canadian market, it's a big market, it's Montreal, it's like a big hockey city, and it kind of energizes these kinds of players. And I'm looking at Eric Staal's career, and this is the first time that he's going to play for a Canadian team in his career. So as a good old Ontario boy from Thunder Bay, I think that's going to be like an extra little motivation for him, because he obviously loves, he talked about in his press conference, he loves playing in Montreal, especially in the past. He played against Montreal a lot, and he was a Habs killer. I think he had around 50 points against the Habs. So he's talked about how much he loves playing in Montreal. I think that's going to be just an extra plus for him, because he's obviously a player that kind of feeds off that type of energy in a building.
It feels a little surreal, to be honest. I've played in this building many times and had some really fun games and competitive games. This is the best atmosphere in the league by far. And now to be joining the group and joining the whole city, being a Montreal Canadian, is pretty phenomenal. That is the direct quote from Eric Staal on that. So
we have some good chemistry going right now, Mackie.
Yeah, it's like
I'm saying
like
stuff
it.
And then you say the quote that goes with it. It's really, yeah.
We got to grow here in terms of the podcast, in terms of this fire that we have. So I like it. Okay, so maybe a little bit about his stats. Like you said, you mentioned briefly that he had some great stats. Why don't you list off exactly what he's been doing in Minnesota? Not in Buffalo. We don't want to touch Buffalo.
You're talking about, okay, yeah. Well, I don't have the years 47 up there. But yeah,
was it 47 points?
Yeah, if we're talking about the last four seasons, like this season obviously has 10 and 32, which isn't great. No one's going to say that's good. But yeah, last year he had 47 points in 56 games played with Minnesota. Then the year prior, 52 points in 81 games. The year before that, he had 76 points in 82 games with 42 goals. So that's just 3 years ago, actually. So, yeah. I mean, Like, this is a guy that at 32 years old scored 42 goals. So it's a force to be reckoned with. If we can put him in the right situations where he can produce, I think one thing too,
we were talking about last week, we were saying like realistic trade scenarios. We said, Ekholm is a long shot. Realistically, we're going to end up with a Glendening or someone like that. So to come out of this with Erik Staal, who his stats speak for themselves, his success speaks for itself. And Erik Staal is not a guy who relied on speed or even, I won't say skill. Obviously, he has high-end talent, but he's not a guy to be making fancy moves in close and stuff. He's a big body. He knows where to be. He's a good passer. He has a good shot. Just a good all-around player who doesn't need to rely on his physicality that much. Obviously, he is a big guy, but he's just a good overall player who you could probably compare to Crosby Light, let's say, in his prime. Just a good leader, good in all aspects of the game, which that's not something that goes away with age. A guy like Kovalchuk, as much as he had success in Montreal, that's a player who relied on his explosiveness and his insane shot. Whereas Staal, I think, has more attributes just to be a well-rounded player. Kind of like Corey Perry, who we can see his legs are gone, but he has that IQ, just that offensive awareness to still be putting up points at this level. And I think Erik Staal, that even in a sheltered fourth line role, if you give him power play time and stuff, it's going to be a positive contribution on this team.
I was going to ask realistically what you think Erik Staal is going to put up as more concrete numbers. Do you think that he's going to edge closer to what he's done on those, you know, I have to say pretty incredible seasons for what I'm looking at in terms of the stats and the PPG? It's pretty remarkable for a 36-year-old to be only one season removed from these types of numbers. So I'm genuinely curious if you guys think that this is the type of player that can come in here and, you know, challenge Phil Danault, or do you see him really at the four? When I say challenge Phil Danault, it's because, you know, Nick Suzuki, Kotkaniemi, obviously I feel like that could be an easy one here where, you know, they have a little drop-off, Erik Staal pops in, but as an established NHL player, do you think that that Erik Staal can do that? Justin, let's start with you.
In terms of him stealing spots from centers, I don't think necessarily that we're going to see like a healthy scratch from any of the top three centers because of Erik Staal coming in. I think he really will kind of replace Jake Evans. And like you said, I think if we see Kotkaniemi or Suzuki start struggling, then yeah, he can move up in the lineup, play some power play time if they want him to. But yeah, I think we have 25 games left on the season. I can see him definitely putting up around like maybe 15 to 20 points if I'm being very optimistic. But yeah, it's all going to be about where they use him. If he's only playing on the fourth line, he could put up like under 10 points, like under like 5 to 10 points, you know? Like if he's getting power play time, if he gets an opportunity to play on the first or second line with like the top end guys like Toffoli and Anderson, or even Corey Perry sparking up that 2012 Team Canada roster, then maybe we can see a more fired up Erik Staal and maybe see more points. But it's really going to come down to how we use him, I think.
Yeah, I agree with Justin.
Sorry, go ahead.
I agree with Justin. I could see him in the half a point a game range. And like you said, depending on usage, I could definitely see him getting a lot of power play time. I don't see why not. This is a guy who's proven himself offensively. And like Corey Perry's shown on the power play, that ability doesn't really go away. And like you mentioned, Mackie, if either Suzuki or Kotkaniemi goes through a little slump, it's a guy who can easily slot in, play with high-skilled line mates. He might not be able to keep up with the pace of the play as much, but that IQ doesn't go away. And I think that's an easy fix if one of these kids goes through a slump. And that's probably one of the reasons Bergevin wanted a guy like this. He's seen our centers struggling. This is very good mentoring for them. And could just help their development for the future.
No disrespect to Jake Evans, but I think that, you know, when you think about looking for offense, Eric Staal is an obvious, you know, plug and play asset that you can use throughout the game. I think if we see that there's a specific line that isn't going, and then you could just pop in Eric Staal, and then like, oh shit, this guy still has the IQ, as you guys all mentioned. We all know that it's based around that, and he's going to be able to make some plays. And I'm curious to see how much chem he can develop with Corey Perry if he does slot in into that fourth line.
That's a slow line, though.
It might be. But like on the power play, like you guys were saying, yeah. I think that might be a very interesting thing. Even you pop in Paul Byron on that fourth line, it might be an interesting combination. But I do agree that it's gonna take a couple of minutes to get up the ice. I think maybe, but I'm obviously joking there. But
yeah, I have a kind of, I don't know if we want to keep talking about Eric Staal's potential for the rest of the year, but I have a little maybe controversial question. Do you think that Marc Bergevin acquired a center in Eric Staal because Jesperi Kotkaniemi is on the COVID list and potentially he could have been the one that tested positive and we want to replace him with a center? Do you think that's what happened?
Very well could be. I don't know, obviously, but I just think that if the price was third and a fifth, he would have taken it anyway. Honestly, because Jake Evans, again, no disrespect to Jake Evans, I think that he's a promising young, bottom six center right now. I don't think that his ceiling is higher than that from what I see right now. I hope I'm wrong, as per usual, when it comes to these takes. But Eric Staal, for a team that wants to make it to the playoffs, it's been a while since we've seen Eric Staal in the playoffs, is another point I wanted to bring up. And I'm very curious to see how he'll add to the group and bringing that winning mentality. Again, that's all intangible things, but I do feel that that's going to be an important piece down the stretch. All right, so we'll move on here. Sorry, I thought Alex might wanted to say something there, but just to end off here on the Eric Staal trade, of course, because this brings up another little subject, given the fact that our episode name, episode 13, is called Poker Face, is that Monsieur Marc Bergevin is not necessarily the most transparent GM. And I saw that there are certain people on Twitter that were vocal about the fact that, like, why can't he just go out and say, you know, that he's trying to acquire? Because what he did was, when he had his first press conference, was saying that it's very unlikely that he'd be that active during the trade deadline, or the before the trade deadline. And now my question is that is this a big issue? And do you like, let me maybe preface this by saying that for Marc Bergevin, he said that he was being honest in the sense that the trade came in very quickly for this one. Sometimes it takes a lot more time. This time it took a lot less time to get it done. And I'm just curious, do you guys give a shit that the GM isn't telling you what he's doing for these types of things? I'll start with you, Alex.
I don't even know what to answer to this. No, I don't care. I don't really have much to comment on this. He can do whatever he wants. It's not for the media to find out his every single move. And if there's deals that are taking place that you don't want leaked, then you don't leak them, and that's that.
But don't you think the fans deserve to know?
No, they don't. What do you mean deserve to know? Deserve to, like, what? They deserve to know so. Once it's finalized and the player's on the team, but when you're negotiating, like, it's, if but another Dubas team finds out, oh, this is the ask for this guy, oh, we can match that. Like, there's no point in getting into this stuff. So, yeah,
Dubas
for me,
came out and said,
no.
Dubas came out and said that he was on the market for a specific player, said that he was willing to give up this much and all of that. So, I'm obviously playing devil's advocate because I completely agree. Just because you're a fan, I don't necessarily think that you have any right for a GM to play his cards in front of you while everybody else is listening. And this is what Marc Bergevin was saying. So the last thing I'll ask is, though, like, at what stage do you see the difference here between a Dubas that's laying the cards in front of everyone and Marc Bergevin that's not? So why is there a difference? And Justin, I'll let you answer.
Well, to me, it's a net negative to kind of say what you're expecting to do. Like, if you can keep your cards.
Justin, I believe I lost you. I don't know if Alex, oh, you fuck. Can hear me.
I yeah. muted myself by accident. I'm sorry. Sorry about that.
All right. Sorry. Go ahead. Before you got interrupted, which was play your cards close to your chest. I think that you were saying something along those lines.
Yeah. So it's actually playing your cards close to the vest.
There we go.
Yeah. So I just think it's a good strategy to keep it on the low. Like, not, you don't let everyone know what you're doing. If everybody knows what you're doing, then they just have more information on how they can negotiate with you and how they can kind of play their cards right to get a better deal out of you. If you know exactly what this person wants, then you can use it to kind of get what you want in the deal. I think it's something that, it's obviously, fans always want to know everything about a hockey team. That's why we're always refreshing our fucking Twitter feed 24/7 to see when's Cole Caulfield signing, when's Eric Staal going to become a Montreal Canadian and all that. But realistically, I just think it makes so much more sense just to keep it to himself as a GM. Like, you don't want to just broadcast everything you're doing. It's just, it's not good business, you know? Like, when you're about to sign a big deal, when you're like Amazon, Jeff Bezos and stuff, you don't put it out on Twitter right before, unless you're Elon Musk, but anyway.
No, but I totally agree. It's like the equivalent of like telling robbers that you're going on vacation. Like, why the fuck would you say that? Like, it's just, there's no reason for Mark Bergevin to do it. And to the fans that think that they are entitled to this information, or even media members, the truth of the matter is that these guys are doing everything that they possibly can to make their team better and to get competitive advantage. Putting your things out there for people to listen to does not help you in any way, apart from being transparent and making, you know, crowd pleasing. So,
yeah,
I mean, just a quick thing.
Yeah, I think there's something to say about like broadcasting that you want to like, let's say for Kyle Dubas, maybe Kyle Dubas doesn't have the types of relationships with GMs that Mark Bergevin does. Maybe he doesn't talk to all GMs every day or every week or so like Mark Bergevin says he does. So if he's kind of saying like, oh, I want to trade this guy, then maybe he's broadcasting a message out to them and reaching them more effectively than like cold calling a GM like that. So maybe that's a strategy. Maybe that's what he's thinking. But I don't know. Like, to me, it's just better to keep your cards close to the vest and do the shit on your own side. Like,
yeah,
fuck the fans.
With all due respect.
No, but fuck what the fans think. Like, who cares? Like, you don't deserve to know anything, like Alex said. Like,
yeah, yeah, 100%. I totally agree. As a fan as well. So you mentioned it in your in our little kind of angry rant about this. Cole Caulfield, 3-year ELC, and will report to Laval after playing his last game in the NCAA. A beautiful video that you shared on our No Respect podcast on Twitter page there. So, obviously, this guy has done wonders, led all skaters in the Big Ten division in 2020-2021 with 52 points, 30 goals, and 22 assists in 31 games. And that was for the University of Wisconsin with the Wisconsin Badgers. So once a Badger, always a Badger, as Cole Caulfield said. But all right, we don't want to overhype this prospect, but we will.
We don't?
Well, that's it. Exactly. So Cole Caulfield now will report to Laval. And he's going to be playing alongside potentially Ryan Poehling, that's been playing great. Some Jesse Ylönen, and I don't know if they play on the same side. I might be fucking that up. But he's going to be playing with those guys. The group has been hot as of late, playing real good hockey and showing some character. I think they did a great comeback win not too long ago. I think that was yesterday.
Tonight.
Yeah. Ryan Poehling playing some outstanding hockey. And yeah, it was tonight, so Sunday night. And I'm genuinely curious, what you guys think the projection of Cole Caulfield will be in terms of imminent future. Will he stay in Laval for the rest of the season? Will he get a sniff with the Montreal Canadiens sooner rather than later? What do you guys think?
I think for me, the only way he doesn't play a game for the Habs this season is if we start going on a tear and when we're firing it all on all cylinders and like we're as dominant as we were in the first seven games of the season, in the first 7 to 10 games of the season. Because if we see that there are sort of holes in our lineup, why not try Cole Caulfield? Like, he's shown that he's such an electrifying player, at least at the NCAA level. Like, he's produced almost a goal a game, which is crazy. And why not try him for a couple of games? Like, I mean, I'm not saying that he's going to come in and play the last 25 games or 20 games of the Habs season. But I think for sure we're going to try him out and have him play a few games, get his feet wet in the NHL, see what he can do. But also feel that him playing in the AHL will definitely do him good, because he's obviously in the NCAA, he's playing against college players. It's not the same league, like it's not the same level. So he does need to adjust to that. And I think that's going to be good for him. But I do think he's going to play a few games at least in a Habs jersey this season.
Alex, your take?
Yeah, I think he's definitely going to play a few games at least. And my take is, I guess, somewhat opposite to Justin. I think if this team is hot and going, I think that's the right time to add a guy like Cole Caulfield and give him opportunities to succeed rather than toss him into this team if they're struggling and hope he can make something happen. I think that's the time you'd want to leave him in the AHL and let him develop there. I've seen like Trevor Zegras in Anaheim, they brought him up and he's not doing so hot. Anaheim's basically trash. And I feel like for a young guy like that, it doesn't really help his development to kind of put all the weight on his shoulders. I know the pressure is not there at least as much as in Montreal and Anaheim, but I don't think it's the right idea to bring Cole Caulfield up if this team isn't doing so well, because the fans' expectations are sky high. My expectations are sky high. The realistic scenario I see, though, is that this team does well. He comes up, he scores almost a goal a game and leads us at least to the finals. But yeah, that's just my take on when he should be brought up. And for the imminent future, he's going to win the Calder next year. If anyone wants to place a sports bet, go for it. You can come for me for the money if you lose the bet, but he's going to win it. And yeah, I mean, it's all hype. This guy's insane. The highlights are insane. The shot is insane. There's only one word, insane. That's it.
I love it.
Just to kind of, because Alex kind of shit on what I said, so... I mean, I don't think they're going to use him as like a last resort. Like, we need this guy to produce to make us better. I meant more that if we're playing so well that we don't want to kind of like fuck up the chemistry on the team.
Yeah.
That's why I didn't, because I don't think that he's going to be useful on like a fourth line. Like, mm-hmm. if you're bringing him in, you want to bring him in to play a top six role. Right. So that's why I'm saying that. Like, I don't think if we have our top six playing so well that we're going to break them up to bring this kid in just to kind of shake things up or something. But
yeah, fair enough. I could agree with that too. Yeah.
Yeah. I would say that for me, you want to make sure that you're not using Cole Caulfield for utility. You want to use him for his development. And if it so happens to fit with the way that the Habs are performing and that he's fitting in, that he has the talent to fit into the NHL, which, you know, he's 5'7". I need to, you know, put on my, I don't want to say pessimistic, but realistic goggles here, where, you know, for him to come in and to be a factor for the Montreal Canadiens this season, I'd love for that to happen, but I feel that's going to be very difficult to do in a team, in a condensed schedule, coming in like the bubble, you're just getting into the NHL. There's no like real warm up here. There's no pregame. There's no nothing. Like it's no preseason games to get into it. Like this is really hot. Like you're coming in as hot as you possibly can for Cole Caulfield, and you know, a player that's of his size, I would think, I could be wrong, and I hope I am, but the physicality of the NHL must be daunting for a player such as Cole Caufield when you're just stepping in. Whereas a guy that's maybe, you know, not as talented, but 6'2" and is a big boy, you know, if he doesn't put it in, he's going to be, you know, not put in danger. You know what I mean? So obviously he has the talent to evade. He has the IQ and stuff like that, but it's still the NHL. So I don't know what's going to happen. I'd love to see him in Laval and take his time. And, you know, the optimistic side of me wants to do exactly verbatim what Alex said, which would be fantastic. And we would all be up in the air in terms of how we feel. But I just don't know if that's a realistic expectation for Cole Caufield, because that's a ton of pressure for a young guy coming into the NHL this hot. So that's my take. I don't know if you guys disagree or agree with that.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with what you said. I agree with what all you guys said. But I guess for the fact that he's smaller, we've seen in the past, like players his height have had success in the NHL. Talking about, obviously, maybe like a Johnny Gaudreau type, like he's like maybe 120 pounds soaking wet. And obviously the Chicago guy that is
Alex DeBrincat.
Thank you very much. It was slipping my mind much.
I saw that. As soon as you're the Chicago guy, I was like, all right, let me step in here.
Perfect. Thank you. And yeah, obviously Bouillon Cube too on the Habs.
Marty St. Louis. I'm going to go Saint-Louis. High there, but that's a bit much.
Yeah.
But,
yeah. So, I mean, players have done it. And I think with his scoring ability, just the fact that he can play like on the power play and score goals on the power play like that, like you don't even need to play him 5-on-5. Like just put him on the power play and he can snipe goals like it's nothing. So, I mean, well, I don't think his game is going to be around using his body as much. Like he's going to be, like you said, like an evasive kind of player, like using his skill and finding the areas. Like, I don't think he's, I don't think he's going to struggle too much in that aspect. Like he's not the type of player to kind of go into board battles and stuff like that. So yeah, we'll see what happens, I guess. Cause I'm just talking out of my ass because we've obviously not seen him play against real men so far. Yeah. So it's kind of, we have to see it before we believe it, I guess.
Yeah. And speaking of other prospects, just a little note from the last podcast where we were almost, 100% sure that Jordan Harris would sign. He did not, decided to opt for his last and final year for the NCAA and finish his studies, which is from a personal level, I think, that's a great move. What that means for the Montreal Canadiens and this player going forward, you can only hope that he decides to stay within the organization. One thing to maybe note that might help is that I'm blanking on his name. I think it's Marc Dumont. Am I getting that name right? The podcast for the
name. Yes.
Yes. Sorry, because there's a lot of Marks in the world, so. Marc Dumont did have an interview with him, and he said that he's super excited to be able to lace it up and play in the Bell Center at one point. So you can take that for what it's worth. Maybe this guy could go back home to the Massachusetts and play for the Boston Bruins. He has that choice if he finishes it up in the NCAA. So hopefully that's not the case and we see Jordan Harris, because he's another touted prospect that's been playing some great hockey in the NCAA. So
can I touch on one size thing for Cole Caufield that people are saying size is an issue and hasn't played against men. If you compare, I think the most common comparison is Alex DeBrincat in Chicago. He came out of the OHL as an 18-year-old as he played with McDavid for a few years or 1 year, but the size of players in the OHL is like, these are young, developing, like almost adults, I guess. Whereas the NCAA, they have 22, 23-year-olds playing there. Obviously it's, again, not comparable to the NHL, but I think the NCAA is probably a higher physicality standard than the OHL. And he didn't really have issues there. These high-end players like DeBrincat, Gaudreau, like people don't really have good concerns about Gaudreau's size when it comes to getting hit and stuff. It's more winning board battles and stuff like that. But like Justin said, that's not really the type of player we're expecting him to be. I don't think he's going to put himself in these dangerous situations where he can get smoked by a D-man. Yeah, maybe he'll be less keen to go into a corner for a battle, but with how the NHL is going, you're not going to get leveled from behind going into the corner. So yeah, that it doesn't concern me too much, that size thing. I could see him being a defensive liability because of it, but I don't see it impacting his offensive game.
Yeah, the only counter that I'll bring up from what I was saying before is the fact that he's coming into a hot season. So DeBrincat, you know, came in. There was there's training camp, preseason games, all of this stuff. Unless he was called up, and I'm not sure of the timeline. But if he's entering the season with the normal protocol and he's not coming into midseason form NHLers that are about to fuck him up on the boards, that's a little bit of a difference for me for a 5'7" guy. But again, same thing. I agree with you that, you know, over time, I think that it won't be an issue whatsoever. I just think in this particular case that it might be something. But
even talking about preseason, like he's still going to the AHL. At least that would be kind of a pre like NHL stage that he can get time in and really kind of feel out what it's like to play against this higher level of player.
Correct. That's true. That's a good point. But yeah, I think we're all on the same page here. It'd be great to see Cole Caulfield, but we don't know if that's going to happen. Hopefully he does. Maybe he lights it up with 3 goals per game in Laval and we fucking see him by next week. Who knows? And speaking about next week, the new schedule is out. So the Habs, I'm not going to get into the details of what's being moved, but the whole thing is that Tuesday we will be playing against the Oilers, Thursday against Ottawa, and Saturday against Ottawa. And the other games have been moved to later dates and there's been slight adjustments here and there. But coming back to this little bit of I want to say outlier here in the sense that we were supposed to be playing quite a bit of hockey this week, 4 games, if I'm not mistaken. And is it fair to say that this mishap here, I don't want to say mishap, I'm hoping that everybody is healthy in terms of the COVID situations. The 2 players that were listed were KK and Armia. I don't have any information on what their status is, but that being said, it did allow the team to have a week off. Do you guys see any positive in that for the Montreal Canadiens?
Well, for me, in terms of just recovering from maybe minor bumps and bruises or injuries, like we saw, obviously Tyler Toffoli and Ben Chiarot are injured right now, so if they can have more time to recover and with less games missed, then that's obviously a plus. But on the other side, there's obviously the tighter schedule. It was already very tight before this whole situation. So we're adding 4 games to the tail end of, well, I guess in the rest of the season. So it's going to be even tighter and games are going to be more important now, because they're just tighter together, I guess. And yeah, so it's good and bad. You can see it both ways. But I think overall, it's just going to be worse overall, because I think just the fact that our schedule is so tight at first was concerning. Now it's even more concerning, maybe not to a massive degree because it is only 4 games. But still, yeah, I think it's worse than it is good. Because it's not like we have like 7 injuries, right?
Correct. Alex,
yeah, I think it's a mixed bag. Like Justin said, yeah, the recovery from injuries to Foley. They're saying he's still not going to play Tuesday, but at least it gives him a bit more time. Maybe a guy like Shea Weber or even Ben Chiarot just gives him a chance to maybe come back for some games towards the end of the year. The one downside obviously is because it was COVID, the team can't even practice together. So if there was anything they were looking to work on, the coach is still fairly new. So I'm sure there's still some stuff he's trying to implement. So that might, put a little hold on that. One positive though, is that Calgary had a disaster of a week. So we kind of come out of this week with quite a few games in hand and still ahead of Calgary. which I'm sure is a boost for the morale of the team. It would have been worse if Calgary had won out their games and you're kind of in a stressful spot coming back thinking, oh shit, we have to win these games or they're ahead of us, right? So mixed bag overall. I don't see a very huge downside to it, but I can see Justin's point that the tighter schedule obviously will affect the energy. Hopefully we can come back out of it with some wins.
I'm hoping that the team's depth is really going to shine in terms of, you know, Jake Allen, Carey Price tandem. Just the depth when you look at the roster here is going to be huge. Ben Chiarot, also one thing I forgot to mention in Marc Bergevin's presser is that he's recovering very well and might be a bit of a speedier recovery than they anticipated. So that's other good news. So I think that's how it's going to shine and hopefully the
knock on wood.
Yes, exactly. What's going to happen for the Habs is that the depth is going to be really useful for this compact schedule and down the stretch. So moving on, this was pretty much of I don't want to say a shocker, but it was pretty unprecedented. Tim Peel was fired this past week after not keeping his mouth shut during right before the TV timeout, where he was quoted, I don't have the exact quote, but basically said, I wanted to get a penalty on Smashville early on fucking Smashville, whatever he said. But obviously this brings up the whole situation that there's been the reffing in the NHL this season. The whole, I guess, debate that we can get into about makeup calls. And from what I gathered, Matt Duchene was saying that he was saying that to Philip Forsberg, if I'm not mistaken. So he was saying
I can tell you the exact quote.
Yeah, go ahead. That's better.
So Tim Peel said, apparently to Philip Forsberg, it wasn't much, but I wanted to get a fucking penalty against Nashville early in the, and then it cut out. So early in the period, basically.
Yeah, exactly. So first and foremost, because now I've changed it from farmost to foremost, so thank you for teaching me that word. What do you guys think about this whole makeup call situation? I like the Tim Peel thing we can maybe get into later on, let me start with the Tim Peel thing. Do you think that this was an acceptable decision from the NHL's perspective? And then we can get into the debate of the makeup calls. So Alex, starting with you, do you think Tim Peel deserved to be fired for this incident?
I think from the NHL's perspective, they had to. Like, you can't promote the integrity of a product and then have a ref come out and say this and just let it slide. Because this affects more than just us as fans watching. Like, sports betting, there's team salaries riding on this. Like, there's a lot more riding on this than just us as fans being like, oh, another shit call. But I think it's ridiculous to believe that the NHL doesn't tell the refs to do this. They just had to save face on this one, I think. It's a business at the end of it, and they had to save the integrity of their product. Again, I'm not sure how many people actually believe it to be the case that it's only Tim Peel doing this. Every single ref does this, I believe. Again, I don't have reffing experience, but from my watching hockey experience, it happens. Players have come out and said it. I mean, of course, as a Montreal Canadiens fan, Tim Peel was probably close to the bottom of my favorites on the list. He's one that's been known to be a bit harsher towards Montreal, but I do feel kind of bad for him. It was his last year. Refs usually get a nice ceremony when they're retiring there with all the players. They get props from everyone there. It's nice for the family, nice for them. So I do feel kind of bad for him, but at the end of the day, the NHL made a business decision, and that's that.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with what you said, but I think it's complete bullshit that they fired Tim Peel over this. Like, I agree that I haven't agreed with a lot of his calls, and he's made some shitty calls in his career. And the fact is, like you said, almost every ref in the league does this and probably explains this to players or explains this to coaches every single game, or maybe not every single game, but most games. And the fact that the NHL comes out and kind of singles out Tim Peel and says, this guy made a mistake, shouldn't have done this, and he's breaking the integrity of the game. It's complete and utter bullshit because they know for a fact that everyone does this. Like, but either come out to. With... I understand that what they had to do there, but it just doesn't make sense from an experienced fan's perspective. You know, as a fan, that every ref is making makeup calls. Like, it's not like it's, oh my god, they discovered it's a tape that's lost in the mail that they found out. Wow, like everybody knows that this happens all the time. Why doesn't the NHL just come out and say, either one way, we should encourage the refs not to do makeup calls, or understand that it's a part of the game, and because for whatever fucking reason, but it's a part of the game that they have to do because of there can be human error that it makes it unfair or something like that. But to single out him when they know that everyone else does it, and we saw refs after this incident covering their mics and not talking, not wanting to have it picked up. Like, it's just like, it's so shit. Like, it doesn't make any sense to me. But yeah, I don't know what you guys think about that. But it's like, to me, it doesn't make any sense to just fire this one guy when it's a league-wide kind of thing that happens with all refs.
It makes total sense to me. It's a sacrificial lamb. That's it.
Yeah, he's the one who got caught. That's it.
That's it. And everything that you were saying in terms of an alternative, if I'm an NHL executive and I'm analyzing scenario A to Z, A being I fired Tim Peel, I say that it's his fault, and I completely exempt myself from any responsibility. And as a casual fan that maybe doesn't know the intricacies of makeup calls and all of this, I have to explain it. If I don't fire him, blah, 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 I'm obviously taking option A. It's as simple as that. And I don't think it's right either. I think makeup calls, they are part of the game. And I'm honestly not opposed to makeup calls. I think that it's a good way to mitigate the human error aspect of things without it impeding, without it being too obvious. Like, if you're making up calls and like the guy, like, you know, he stroked the guy with his hand on the bench or something, and you're saying like that's a roughing, that's one thing. But if it's something that could have been not called and you're calling it to make up the fact that there's an advantage that needs to be kind of balanced throughout a competitive sport, I'm totally fine with it. I could be completely wrong and people think that this is complete bullshit, but I wanted to get into this because for me, makeup calls is just purely a way of simplifying the refereeing job without it getting overly complex. I don't know if you guys agree.
I could see that side of it, definitely. And the main issue I see with hockey as opposed to other sports I watch is that the pace is usually faster, and a lot of these stick penalties are very, very hard to judge in real-time speed. When you're watching in slow-mo, it's obvious to say, oh, he didn't actually clip him in the hand, so that's not a slash. Or he didn't actually hook him, the guy tripped on his own. But these guys skating 40 kilometers an hour, he catches an edge and the stick is half an inch away from his skate blade. It's kind of hard to tell. And I think hockey is the one sport as well that if you blow the whistle and people say, oh, we should get a video review of this penalty, right? If you start going into these reviews, you kill all the momentum of the game, as opposed to sports like football and stuff where it's a stoppage of the play every time anyway. Hockey, if a team's in a cycle and you decide to blow the whistle and then it's like, oh, well, it wasn't actually a penalty, we'll do the face-off again. Well, you've killed the team's momentum. You took away the scoring chance. That's it, right? So it's definitely probably the hardest sport to ref, I'd say, just because of the speed of it, the sticks, the skates. You're on ice. People slip sometimes. I don't know. It's a tough game to ref. I feel bad for the refs. I do somewhat agree with what you're saying about the makeup calls. I feel like we're probably going to get blasted for this take. But I agree with you that it is a somewhat fair way to make up for these human errors. And I think the reason for that is that it's a game that's basically impossible to avoid human error just because of the pace of it.
Yeah, I mean, I totally agree that it's impossible to not have human error with reffing in the NHL. Like, the fact that there's so many different penalties that are, like, since 2005, they added, like, the hooking penalties. Like, every penalty is a stick infraction that can be caught behind the play anywhere. So it's hard to make these calls as a ref because it moves so fast, like Alex said. But to me, makeup calls aren't fair just because they're so inconsistent. Like, you can have a time where, let's say, they missed a call with one team, so they're like, okay, we'll call a penalty for the other team to compensate. And okay, that's fair. But what if it's a kind of thing where they're like, we want to call a penalty early to show that we're calling penalties this game, but we don't want any bullshit after the whistle and stuff like that. And that ends up being a power play. They score the first goal and then it ends up 1-0 and they win the game because of that. Or something like that. Like, the timing of these makeup calls too. Like, if you're not going to call a makeup call in the last 5 minutes of a game, right? Mm-hmm. And like, just the fact that it's so inconsistent and there's no, like, I know I always talk about kind of black and white when there's obviously there's a lot of gray area in reffing and in hockey and everything, but I don't know. To me, reffing should be black and white. Like, you should be calling penalties when you see them, not looking for penalties. And I think hockey in particular is a sport where if you're looking for a penalty, you can find one, especially in this NHL, like where slashing is a penalty. When you slash on it, like close to a player's hands, you could call that as a penalty. Right. So I just think it's so easy for the refs to make makeup calls when they want to, that it gives them like too much control over managing the game. So to me, that just makes it, I don't know. I feel like it gives too much power to the refs. And as much as it's trying to kind of make the game more fair when they make mistakes, I don't necessarily think they should be the ones that are doing that. They should just call the game as they see it, not look for calls when they feel like they should make one. Just be completely unbiased in terms of how the play is going on. Just call the penalties. That's what I would want.
With great power comes great responsibility. That's one of my favorite quotes from Spider-Man 1. Probably the only, like, Uncle Ben. Yeah, R.I.P.
R.I.P.
All I was going to say is that as long as you have good judgment, I feel like it can be mitigated. Everything that you said, like, there's been times that I feel
so
like...
So you feel like all the refs have good judgment, though?
No, that's a different story entirely. In terms exactly, of consistency, though. I totally agree with you, but that's just a general problem that we're seeing in the NHL. I don't think it's specific to makeup calls, and that's really why I just don't feel like it's too much of an issue to have that in the game. So, guys, if you disagree, tell us why. Let us know in the comments down below. Send us a tweet, whatever you guys want, because I'm genuinely curious. Makeup calls, yes or no? Okay? All right. Ladies and gentlemen, we're getting to an unprecedented event on the No Respect podcast. We started off our podcast in French, and we're going to go with a segment to finish off today's show. We'll come back to English. So for those of you who are Anglophone and only speak English, you can maybe fast forward a couple of minutes until we finish, unless you want to see us try to speak French as best as we can. This is going to be weird for us because we only speak English to each other usually. So this is going to be a little of an adjustment, but we wanted to give ourselves a little challenge. And for those of you who are listening, I forgot to shout out at the top of the show. So a huge apology from me. A couple of names that I'm just going to throw out. Of course, Shane at 33 Habs, huge thank you. Because he was saying that if we don't do the podcast this week, there's no respect. So Adam Pelter, this guy's an OG. He's been liking our tweets and been a little bit more vocal with us this year. Huge thank you. Huey sent us an image of Elmer Lack playing baseball in 1944. Fantastic. Thank you so much, Huey. Another great, great listener. Mathieu M. MTL Maxandre. I want to dedicate this French portion of the podcast to you guys and to everyone else that we potentially missed. We apologize, but
thank you
for listening.
Sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
Arne Cossé Canadien. All right.
Yes.
What did I say? Was that what his name is?
Yeah, I think it is Arne Cossé Canadien.
That's but he was very excited to practice his French. As so I don't know how much we're gonna be how good we're
gonna
be.
We're not, we're not we'll setting any helpful. High standards.
Yeah, no,
exactly. Exactly.
So don't take tips from us, please. I haven't spoken French since I haven't spoken like three sentences strung together since probably high school.
Okay, so here we go. Without further ado, we're gonna do a quick seamless transition to français. Et voilà. On y est arrivé. OK, ben là, c'est le No Respect Podcast. Ça va être difficile à faire ça en français, surtout avec des amis anglophones, mais on le fait anyway. Et ça va être un petit mélange d'anglais et français parce que c'est de même que je parle. Donc, mesdames et messieurs, pour cette partie en français, qu'est-ce que nous allons faire? C'est faire un petit jeu avec notre ami Justin pour trivia. Si vous ne connaissez pas la chronique Trivia, ben c'est un petit jeu où est-ce que Justin nous pose des questions à moi puis Alex et le gagnant reçoit absolument rien. Donc, je laisse la parole à Justin pour la question qui va nous poser.
Une chose, Maki, tu parles comme Justin Trudeau, notre premier ministre.
Ouais. Ah, merci beaucoup, merci.
C'est quoi le mot? Intonation? Is that a word?
Ah, peut-être. Yeah, I think so.
Donc, comme un trou de cul.
La même cadence.
Ah, excellent. Excellent.
Donc, c'est très émouvant.
On veut utiliser des mots qu'on ne connaît pas. mais donc, je laisse la parole à Justin pour la première question de trivia.
Oh, merci. OK, donc, j'ai quatre questions.
Oh boy.
Bon, yep, exactement. Donc, je les écris ici. Donc, la première question. Donc, Marc Bergevin, le GM de Montréal, aime recruter des gagnants de la Coupe Stanley. Oh my God. Stop laughing. Fuck you guys.
C'est bizarre. I'm sorry.
Donc, premièrement, combien de joueurs chez les Canadiens ont gagné la Coupe Stanley?
En ce moment.
Combien de joueurs?
En ce moment.
Il y a Corey Perry.
Comme des joueurs qui jouent présentement?
Oui, oui.
OK, ouais. Sinon, mais ça pas, serait...
Ouais, exactement. Comme pas dans l'histoire des Canadiens.
OK, OK.
Be here all day, fuck.
moi, je vais dire... Attends, je vais faire la liste dans ma tête, puis...
Mais tu peux juste les nommer, c'est comme...
OK. Corey Perry?
Oui.
Eric Stahl?
Joel Edmondson?
Joel, oui.
Jake Allen? Oui. Eric Stahl.
Ouais.
Attends, y a-tu un autre?
Ouais. Y a-tu juste à dire ça.
Y a-tu un autre? Non? Y a-tu un autre?
Y en a deux autres.
Ah, tabarnak. attends-moi.
OK, come on, les boys.
What?
OK. Un dans les deux, c'est un gars qui a pas joué un jeu cette année.
Ah, tabarnak.
Un jeu.
OK.
Un match, fuck you.
We said it'd be a struggle, ladies and gentlemen. Mais moi, je vais dire Michael Frolik, bien évidemment.
OK.
Mais il y a un dernier.
Oui.
Qui j'ai manqué?
Un des top scorers.
Tyler Toffoli, wow, c'est vrai.
Ah, tabarnak.
Avec les Kings de Los Angeles.
Oui, ça c'est
Los
vrai.
Los Angeles, ouais.
Ouais.
So,
ouais.
Lui a gagné en 2014. Michael Frolik en 2013.
Excellent.
Corey Perry, 2007. Anaheim. Eric Stahl, 2006 en Caroline.
Ouais, je m'en
rappelle. Jake Allen, 2019, St. Louis. And Joel Edmondson,
ben
lui
oui.
aussi, en 2019.
Excellent.
OK, donc...
Hey, excellente question,
c'est pas
Justin.
Payé, ça? C'est pas payé?
Hey, so that was our first attempt at French, so for those of you who are still listening... Hang on, I just need to say thank you for listening if you're trying this out. So, on continue en français. Let's go.
Ouais, OK. Question numéro 2. Est-ce que tu peux nommer... les noms des trois frères à Eric Staal.
Yes.
Ouais, OK, les trois frères.
Pas de problème, pas de problème. Il y a Mark, Jordan, puis Jared.
OK. T'es sûr?
Ouais.
Oui.
Final answer?
Final answer.
Ding, ding, ding!
Nay! There we go. Excellent.
Et tu peux-tu nommer la ligue où ce que Jared
Attends,
Staal...
Justin, pouvez-vous oui. me vous voyez?
Non.
OK.
Non, je te vois pas. Est-ce que okay. vous pouvez nommer... I fucking forgot how to conjugue the vous verb. Fuck. Est-ce que the vous pouvez verb. Me nommer la ligue où ce que Jared Staal joue en ce moment?
Je pense que c'est à... C'est Washington, non?
Ouf.
Il joue à Washington.
La Ligue.
Ouais, mais il joue... Ben,
il joue pas dans la NH.
La East Coast Hockey League.
Ouais, c'est ça que j'allais dire.
C'est prêt, mais c'est pas ça. C'est pas prêt. Anyway.
C'est okay. la WHL.
Non. C'est pas dans ce continent.
Oh, tabarnak.
La DHL en Allemagne.
OK.
En Allemagne?
Non, c'est pas ça.
C'est pour Quichi.
Arnold Quichi, guess.
La SM Shout Liga en Finlande.
Non.
Okay. Maki. Dernier, Mike c'est Mikael. KHL.
Non. C'est non. le... E-I-H-L. Avec les Edinburgh Capitals.
Edinburgh.
Okay. Donc, Mackie, avec son guest de Washington, était pas mal prêt, je pense.
Ouais. Écoute.
Paul Bissonnette, Biznasty, a joué dans cette ligue, je crois. Durant le lockout.
Ah, c'est mieux, ça. Je savais
c'est
pas.
Wait. EIHL, c'est England?
Je crois que oui. Ouais.
Ouais, ben...
Mais Edinburgh, c'est...
C'est
Écossais,
non?
Écosse.
Yeah. Écosse. Ouais. Oh, un Écossais canadien.
Ben voilà. Ben
That's
voilà.
why I had the question, fuck.
Okay. Ouais, exact.
Parfait, ça. OK. Good job, les boys.
Let's go. Ben okay. merci. J'ai rien fait.
OK, ça, c'est un peu un follow-up. Mais combien d'entre eux, les frères Staal, ont joué pour les Hurricanes de Caroline?
Trois.
Deux.
3.
2.
C'est 3.
Non!
Oui. Donc, Eric, Jordan et Jared.
Ah,
Jared a joué deux matchs.
Il y avait la fameuse photo ou la fameuse partie où les trois frères étaient alignés pour le premier face-off.
Ouais.
Okay. Don Moi, Jerry je pensais que Jared a été invité plus tard, là, puis la suite. Non,
ouais,
okay.
c'est ça. OK, ouais. so... La prochaine question, puis c'est la dernière, thank God. Donc, ça va mal chez les Sabres, ou les Sabres, excuse-moi. Ils ont perdu 17 matchs de suite, ce qui leur donne la deuxième place dans les plus longues suites de défaites dans l'histoire de la NLH. Donc, ma question...
Ben.
Ouais, ça va pas bien. Donc, ma question, quelle équipe a la plus longue suite de défaites dans l'histoire de la NLH. Et c'est combien de matchs?
C'est soit San Jose ou Washington. Et c'est 19, je crois.
En fait, moi, je vais dire soit Toronto, pour aucune raison d'autre que le fait que c'est Toronto. Et sinon, je vais dire Détroit récemment, si je me trompe pas.
Oh. Des bons guesses. Ben, Alex est vraiment proche. Washington et San Jose étaient deuxième avec 17, comme les Sabres. Donc, very close. Ça, c'était en 92 puis pour les Sharks, puis 75 pour les Caps. And dans la première... Au premier rang, c'est les Penguins de Pittsburgh avec 18.
Ah, 18?
Ouais.
C'était quelle année, ça?
2003-2004. Okay, le tank season.
Juste avant, OK, OK, ouais. C'est juste avant... ça, c'est-tu Crosby? Non, ça, c'est Malkin.
Je
pense que c'est Malkin. Je me trompe pas. Parce que Malkin a été sélectionné une année.
Je pense que c'était son premier... C'est... Wait, what? OK, one sec. Non? Je pense que c'est Crosby.
C'est Crosby en premier? Ça se peut, hein? Je me trompe.
Oh non. OK, never mind. Non, c'était avant qu'ils ont eu Crosby.
OK. Est-ce que c'était Malkin avant ça? Mais non.
Je sais pas, je m'en calisse.
OK. Bon, OK, ben, c'est-tu tout pour trivia
ouais,
avec
c'est
Justin?
Tout. C'est tout. Merci d'avoir joué. Merci beaucoup.
Fait plaisir.
Alex,
je donne Alex 2 points, puis okay. Maki 0. Donc,
ouais. OK, super. Écoute, on va prendre ça.
Parfait, ça.
Ben, écoute, merci pour ton travail pour trivia avec Justin. Justin. On va finir cette chronique en français avec quelques, je veux dire, opinions pour qu'est-ce qui va se passer. pas des opinions, là, mais des... c'est des hot takes, OK? Je vais dire ça en français.
Des opinions...
C'est quoi?
Je sais pas.
Ben voilà.
Brillante.
Donc ma question, puisque... On vient juste d'acquérir, c'est un bon mot, je pense, Eric Staal. On vient juste de signer Cole Caulfield, Jordan Harris, sans Chris. moi, je voulais vous demander qu'est-ce que vous pensez ou qu'est-ce que vous envisagez pour le restant de la saison si vous avez des surprises en tête pour quelques joueurs, soit négatifs, soit positifs. Ça ne me dérange pas. Mais qu'est-ce que vous pensez, puisqu'on est sur le sujet des Canadiens puis le restant de la saison? Je vais commencer avec Alex.
Ouf! Des surprises. Je veux dire que Tyler Toffoli va continuer de marquer autant de buts qu'il marque jusqu'à date cette saison. Donc Toffoli va finir avec 35 buts cette saison.
OK.
Je crois aussi que c'est Jonathan beaucoup. Drouin va finir notre meilleur pointeur.
OK. C'est positif,
et
ça.
Et okay. Une surprise pour moi, mais je vais dire que Carey Price va avoir une fin de saison très solide. Je peux pas vous donner comme des chiffres pour les stats, mais... Okay. Il va me surprendre parce que je suis un hater de Carey Price. Donc, il va avoir une fin de saison très solide et ça va se poursuivre dans les séries. Et je ne serais pas surpris de voir Carey Price être un des noms dans le chapeau pour le trophée Conn Smythe. Is it Conn Smythe, okay. MVP?
Ouais, OK. Ben, Conn Smythe, ouais. ça c'est si tu arrives à la finale, hein? C'est pas juste un one round puis t'es fini.
Non, c'est le heart. C'est le heart dans la saison régulière.
Ah, tu parles de saison régulière?
Non, en série. En série.
Ouais, non, en série.
Mais
quand en série, c'est impossible.
Ils doivent se rendre en finale?
Non. Ben oui. Ben absolument.
GS Giguère was the last goalie. Ouais.
Ben,
ouais, non.
In theory, non. Mais.
Non, mais c'est impossible. Okay, impossible.
Ouais. OK, impossible. Fini.
Non, mais ça peut être possible dans le sens que les Canadiens doivent se rendre au final, mais c'est impossible qu'ils soient pris.
Les Canadiens vont se rendre en finale.
Est-ce Carey qu'ils vont Price?
Non. Carey Price ne va pas nécessairement gagner le trophée Conn Smythe, mais son nom va être dans le chapeau.
OK, dans le chapeau métaphorique. OK, je comprends. OK. Ouais. Très bien. Ben écoute, ça c'est beaucoup de surprises positives pour Alex.
Je vais être honnête,
enchaîner.
J'ai
avec...
juste choisi des surprises que je suis capable d'énoncer
d'exprimer.
En français.
Ouais. Bon, ben on continue avec Justin. Est-ce que tu as des surprises, soit positifs, négatifs, pour le restant de la saison?
Ouais, je pense que c'est peut-être pas un surprise, mais Josh Anderson, il a déjà 11 buts cette saison. Je pense qu'il va, il va finir avec 25.
Mm-hmm. 25, OK.
25. Donc, 14 plus 11, c'est 25.
Je peux faire.
Tu follow? OK, c'est bon. Je pense que j'ai pas des nombres, des chiffres.
Mais t'avais 25.
Mais je pense que Nick Suzuki puis Shea Weber, après cette semaine de relâche due à la COVID, vont être très, mais beaucoup plus bons, meilleurs dans leur jeu. Et ouais, c'est pas mal ça pour moi.
Excellent. C'est assez vague, mais
j'ai choisi des affaires que je pouvais pas dire en français, en fait.
Ah, oh, ladies and gentlemen, this is going great. Donc, je vais finir ici avec qu'est-ce que moi j'envisage pour le restant de la saison. Pour moi, j'aimerais bien croire que Carey Price va continuer sur cette progression avec. Surtout, on en a parlé durant l'épisode, mais Sean Burke a parlé du travail qu'il fait avec Carey Price, puis je pense que, comme toi, Alex, qui va continuer à progresser sur son jeu. Sinon, je crois la surprise va être la ligne de Dano Tatar et Brendan Gallagher qui vont vraiment émerger. Ben, je veux pas dire émerger, mais réémerger en tant que trio. Je veux dire fondationnel. Non, c'est pas un mot du tout. Mais comme j'ai dit dans d'autres épisodes, qu'on a besoin que de cette ligne pour être une équipe qui est très efficace. Tu rajoutes Eric Staal à ce groupe, mais je pense que c'est très important que cette ligne soit la ligne qu'on a vue dans les années précédentes pour que cette équipe ait du succès. Surtout avec cette... comment tu dis ça? Calendrier qui est condensé. Donc, ça, c'est la surprise positive. La seule chose que je vais dire qui est négatif, je pense que Shea Weber va continuer dans la même trajectoire de sa performance, malheureusement. C'est parce que on était tous positifs. Je vais dire la seule chose qui est sur mon... que je crains. Pour moi, c'est ça. Ça va être... Shea Weber qui continue à pas être le défenseur qu'on veut qu'il soit. Puis that's it. C'est bon?
Je pense que t'es dans le champ, Carlis.
Ben écoute, il faut donner nos opinions, c'est ce qu'on a fait. And ladies and gentlemen, that does it for the French portion of the No Respect podcast. This was the first time. Let us know how we did. You want to roast us for our French, for our syntax, for all of that good stuff, you can go ahead. For those of you who missed trivia because we spoke in French, we spoke about who were the last, how many cup winners that we have.
You don't even know what we're talking about.
Staal brothers. Yeah, I'm trying to translate everything that we spoke about. It's difficult. And then after that, our hot takes for this season. A lot of them were positive from Alex, as well as Justin. The only negative that I had was the Shea Weber not necessarily coming back up to the level that we need him to be. But yeah, to finish off today's show, let's talk about this week's games. Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. First up, Edmonton, and then the rest. It's our Ontario neighbors. Ottawa. What do you guys think, Justin?
I think we're going to go through some kind of problems coming from the week of not playing and only practicing one day. So I think we're going to lose against Edmonton, who obviously have some firepower. And then I think we're going to win a couple of hard-fought games against Ottawa because they always put up a fight against us. But I think at the end of the day, I think we're going to win those two. So 2-1 for me.
Alex.
Sí, yo creo que nosotros vamos a terminar la semana en 3-0. Los Oilers. Okay, I thought that was the Spanish part. I think we're going to go 3-0. It's going to be a big bounce back week after this week off. I'm sure the players are ready to go. I'm hyped to go. I think we shut McDavid down. The Senators did us a favor by destroying Calgary twice in a row. I think we'll do the opposite to them. And yeah, big week for the team. This is a statement week. They have to come out strong after this and build that gap with Calgary. But looking forward to it. I call 3-0.
I like it. I like the positivity. I want to go there with you. I'm going to say that it's going to be a little bit of a rougher week. And I think that we're going to actually win against the Oilers. I do think we're going to lose against the Ottawa Senators, though, one more time. So it's going to be the same thing as you, Justin, where it's 2-1. But I think that the moral impact of the loss against, let's say, Ottawa will be heavier on this team. That being said, I do believe that it's going to be part of the fact that they're just coming back. So onwards and upwards for the Montreal Canadiens from my part, but a little bit of a rougher week, I think, potentially. So we'll see what happens. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, we want to thank you for listening to this podcast. We thought it was going to be short. It's a little bit shorter, but for the amount of stuff that happened this week with no games, it's still an hour and 16 minutes about. So a huge thank you for listening all the way through. Thank you for enduring our French segment for our Francophone listeners. And for those of you who are Anglophone and listen to our French segment, God bless you. I'm looking at you, Ernie Casset.
Can you believe we went to high school in French?
No.
Like,
you guys are good. I
understand why we got made fun of in high school now, just. Like, 100%. I kind of get why they made fun of us. But
yeah, listen. Me too. I think we did okay.
No, that's not bad, yeah.
Yeah, not bad for people that just speak English amongst themselves. It was also weird speaking to you guys in French, but...
Yeah, you guys were laughing halfway through my fucking first word.
I'm sorry.
Jesus Christ.
You came in with an intonation that I just wasn't expecting. It was it was great. But without further ado, again, I'll say this. A thank you, but a reminder that you can always reach us at No Respect Podcast on Twitter. If not, we've got our personal handles, Mackie_No Respect. That's Macky underscore No Respect. Justin_No Respect. Alex_No Respect. And a friendly reminder, if you guys are enjoying the content, a follow, a subscribe, a comment, all of these things would be greatly appreciated. But again, all up to you guys. If you're lurking, we love you anyway. And we just hope that you're enjoying and you're a big Hab fan. So go Habs go. On behalf of Alex, Justin, and myself, Mackie, we always remind you to respect the...
Orgasination.
Have a great one and go Habs go. Merci aux partisans des Canadiens.